وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
So Imam al-Bukhari, he said, Babu qawli Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, waylun lil arabi min sharrin qad iqtarab. He said, حدثنا مالك بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا ابن عيينة أنه سمع الزهري عن عروة عن زينب بنت أم سلمة عن أم حبيبة. This hadith, as I mentioned, Bukhari narrated from Malik ibn Ismail. Let's focus on this chain of narration because there's some benefits in this. This is a very powerful benefit in this, inshallah ta'ala. Bukhari is narrating it from his teacher, whose name is Malik ibn Ismail, who is called Malik ibn Ismail ibn Ziyad al-Nahdi, who said, حدثنا ibn Uyayna. Ibn Uyayna here is Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Sufyan narrated from Az-Zuhri, and Zuhri is Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Shihab Az-Zuhri, the great Tabi'i, who heard from Urwat ibn Zubayr, the brother of Abdullah ibn Zubayr, his maternal auntie was our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Then the hadith is three female companions. Listen to it. An Zainaba binti Ummi Salama. Zainaba binti Ummi Salama is the daughter of Ummu Salama, the Prophet's wife. Does that make sense? Then Zainaba binti Ummi Salama is Rabibatul Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She grew up in the Prophet's house. She's a female companion. And Ummi Habiba and Zainaba binti Jahsh are what? Both the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ummahati al-Mu'mineen. So we have three female companions in this chain. Now, some of the scholars, they criticize al-Imam al-Bukhari here. Just one time I'm going to go into this issue, okay? Some scholars, they criticize al-Imam al-Bukhari. I'm just going to mention this as a side benefit, inshallah ta'ala. Which is, Imam Muslim narrated the same hadith. Who? Al-Imam Muslim. And Muslim narrated it from four people other than Malik ibn Ismail. Malik ibn Ismail is the teacher of who? Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Muslim avoided Malik ibn Ismail, the first man in the chain. And he took four other individuals who narrated it. And they are Abu Bakr ibn Abi Shayba, Sa'id ibn Amr, Zuhair ibn Harbin, Abu Khaythamah Zuhair ibn Harbin, and Muhammad ibn Yahya ibn Abi Umar. These four. These four who Muslim chose to narrate from, through to Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Zuhri, like that. These four, they made the female companions four and not three. Like this chain. They placed in between Zainaba binti Ummi Salama and Ummi Habiba. They increased in there between that Habiba herself, the daughter of Ummu Habiba, who's also what? Rabibatul Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So two women, young girls who grew up in the Prophet's house, which is Zainaba bint Ummi Salama and Habiba, and two wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is Ummu Habiba and Zainaba bint Jahsh. Why did Bukhari avoid those four and take this one? The reason is because Bukhari did that because this is the only chain where it's clearly stated that Sufyan ibn Uyayna heard from Zuhri. Because this hadith says, حدثنا ibn Uyayna تأنه سمع الزهرية. That's why Bukhari wanted to bring this one. Last benefit that I want to mention from this chain, and I won't go into this detail anymore, okay? Don't worry. The last benefit I want to mention from this chain is this hadith itself, Bukhari narrated it another place at the ending of Kitab al-Fitan, and he narrated it, and the sanad is Tusa'i. Tusa'i is how much? 9. And that's the longest chain in Sahih al-Bukhari. Bukhari is the shortest chain between him and the Prophet. How much? The shortest. 3. The longest is how much? 9. And the longest one is which one? This one. He narrated it as the longest version of it in Kitab al-Fitr at the ending, inshallah ta'ala. All of that, Hafiz ibn Hajar mentions it in Fath al-Bari. Zainab binti Jahshin is the Prophet's wife. Who is she? She's the Prophet's wife, and she was married to previously before that. Who? Zayd ibn Harith. And Zainab binti Jahshin, the Prophet married her from a command high above. ولذلك Zainab used to say to the other wives of the Prophet, زَوَّجَكُنَّ أَهَلِكُنَّ. Your family married you guys off. وَزَوَّجَنِ اللَّهِ. Allah married me off. مِنْ فَوْقِ سَبْعِ السَّمَاوَاتِ. From high above. Are we all together? So Zainab binti Jahshin, Allah stated her story in the Quran. Allah stated her issue in the what? In the Quran. Allah mentioned her story in the Quran. Zainab, she said, أنها قالت استيقظ رسول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من النوم. The Prophet woke up one morning from his sleep. محمرًا وجهه. The Prophet's face was red. عليه الصلاة والسلام. His face was محمرًا وجهه. His face was red. يقول, the Prophet said, لا إله إلا الله. There is none worthy of worship except Allah. ويل للعرب. Wail be to the Arabs. من شر. From an evil. قد اقترب. That has come close. The Prophet is trying to point this out. An evil has come close. فتح اليوم من ردم يأجوج ومأجوج مثل هذه. ذو القرنين. What did he build? He built a fortress between us and what? ذو القرنين. That fortress between us, يأجوج and مأجوج, they opened a amount of it. Are we all together? Question here. Did the opening of Ya'juj wa Ma'juj stop? Or is it still going on? Is it still opening every time a little bit? Or is it just at that moment when the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned it? Hafiz ibn Hajar brings a statement of Ibn Battal. He said, أَنْذَرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِي حَدِيثِ زَيْنَبَ بِقُرْبِ قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ كَيْ يَتُوبُ قَبْلَ أَنْ تَهْجُمَ عَلَيْهِمْ. This hadith of Zainab bint Jahshin, the Prophet was warning the people. And he's warning them, the hour is close. And what does he want from them? The Prophet ﷺ, كَيْ يَتُوبُ, so they can repent before the hour comes, before Ya'juj wa Ma'juj comes. وَقَدْ ثَبَتَ أَنَّ خُرُوجَ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجَ قُرْبُ قِيَامِ السَّاعَةِ فَإِذَا فُتِحَ مِنْ رَدْمِهِمْ ذَاكَ الْقَدْرُ فِي زَمَنِ صلى الله عليه وسلم لَمْ يَزَلِ الْفَتْحُ يَتَّسِعُ عَلَى مَرِّ الْأَوْقَاتِ. So the opening, Ibn Battal is saying, it started then and it's becoming bigger and bigger and bigger. The narrations have stated that. Okay. وَقَدْ جَاءَ فِي حَدِيثِ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَفْعُهُ. And this has come in the Prophet's statement where he said, وَيْلٌ لِلْعَرَبِ. Wail be to the Arabs. مِنْ شَرٍ قَدْ اِقْتَرَبْ. An evil has come close. مُوتُوا إِنِ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Die if you guys wish. Hafiz ibn Hajar, he said, that Ibn Battal said, وَهَذَا غَايَةٌ فِي التَّحْذِيرِ مِنَ الْفِتَنِ وَالْخَوْضِ فِيهَا حَيْثُ جَعَلَ الْمَوْتُ خَيْرًا مِنْ مُبَاشَرَتِهَا. That the death becomes better than this fitna that's going to come. To die will become better than coming in contact with this fitna of Ya'juj wa Ma'juj. When they come, brothers, even Isa ibn Maryam, who killed Dajjal, cannot do anything. And him and his followers, Isa, will be commanded to go into a mountain and to stay there. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will destroy them. So when Ya'juj wa Ma'juj come, mufsiduna fil ardi, they're going to bring fasad. Fasad and corruption is what they're going to bring to the world. So what did, look what Ibn Battal said. Before that time comes, what is it that is needed from us? Repentance. To turn to Allah. The hadith is going to mention all of this to us. And I want you to all listen. The Prophet said, Ya'juj wa Ma'juj is opening. Then the Prophet was asked, Anahlaku, are we going to be destroyed? Some of the narrations state that Zainab herself asked the Prophet. She said, Ya Rasulullah, Are we going to be destroyed when Ya'juj and Ma'juj come? And this corruption and everything comes. Are we going to be destroyed? وَفِينَ الصَّالِحُونَ And amongst us are righteous people. We have good people amongst us. عَابِدِين People who are praying. Aesthetic people. Noble people. People who fear Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Are we going to be destroyed? The Prophet said, نَعَمْ Yes. إِذَا كَثُرَ الْخَبَثُ When the evil becomes a lot. When the evil becomes large, the righteous people's ibadah and their good doing will not change anything. It will not what? It will not change anything. And that's why Abu Hurairah, when he was saying, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min ra'si sittina wa imarati sibyan. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in you before the Islamic calendar becomes 60. Oh Allah, Abu Hurairah saying, Oh Allah, don't make me reach that time. Wa imarati sibyan, and when the young kids are in control of things. In other words, he knew that the presence of the righteous people will not do anything. The presence of the righteous people, it won't do anything. It won't do anything. So we need to repent to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala before this evil comes. And those dim-witted ones who are trying to turn away from that path of goodness, whilst we have the ability, we should advise them. Because when the fitna comes, brothers, and that adab comes, it is not restricted to the evil wrongdoers. It's going to happen to everybody. Are we all together? The Prophet ﷺ, he said, يَا مَعْشَرَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ خَمْسُ خِصَالٍ إِذَا ابْتُلِيتُمْ بِهِنَّ وَأَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ أَن تُدْرِكُوهُنَّ لَمْ تَظْهَرِ الْفَاحِشَةُ فِي قَوْمٍ قَطْ The Prophet said, يَا مَعْشَرَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ مُهَاجِرِينَ خَمْسُ خِصَالٍ Five things, if you're tested with it, وَأَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ And I seek refuge in Allah that you meet these five things. لَمْ تَظْهَرِ الْفَاحِشَةُ Wrongdoing and crimes do not become apparent on the land. إِلَّا فَشَى فِيهِمُ الطَّاعُونَ وَالْأَوْجَاعُ وَالْأَمْرَاضُ أَلَّتِي لَمْ تَكُنْ فِي أَسْلَافِهِمُ الَّذِينَ مَضَوْا That when that wrongdoing and those crimes and those evil become apparent and everyone is doing it, Allah is going to bring illnesses, plague, sicknesses. أَلَّتِي لَمْ تَكُنْ فِي أَسْلَافِهِمُ الَّذِينَ مَضَوْا And those sicknesses will not have been present in the early people. They will not have heard of that illness. New illnesses, AIDS, HIV, that the early people didn't know of. Why did it come, HIV and AIDS and all of this? Because people were told, stay away from zina. Stay away from it. Don't do it. No, we want to do it. Don't do it. No, we won't do it. We want to do it. Okay, do it. These illnesses came from it then. These illnesses came from it. Are we all together? So the mukhalafa and opposing the sharia, it has consequences. And when those consequences come, the Prophet said in another hadith, لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوُنَّ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَلَتَأْخُذُنَّ يَدِ السَّفِيهِ You're going to command the good, and you're going to prohibit the evil, and you're going to grab the hand of the dim-witted one. أَوْ لَيُشِكَنَّ اللَّهِ Or it's close. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will bring an adab that will take each and every one of you. Are you with me? It'll take everyone. So you advise your family members and you talk to it. And that's why we have to all start from our own households. Are we all together, brothers? Our what? Our own households. Everybody advises their family members, their neighbors. Everybody does that. قال البخاري رحمه الله حدثنا أبو نعيم بخاري said أبو نعيم Who's أبو نعيم؟ أبو نعيم فضل بن الدكين He's a teacher of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Yeah, and the teacher of Yahya ibn Ma'in, Abu Nu'aym, Fadl ibn Dukayn. His name is Amr ibn Hamad ibn Zuhair ibn Dirham ibn Tamimi, Al-Mullai al-Kufi, Thiqatun Thabtun Hujja, Akhraj Hadithu al-Jama'ah, Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawud, Tirmidhi ibn Majah, Al-Nasai, all of them narrated from him. And he's the man that kicked Yahya ibn Ma'in on the chest when he tried to test him. He got angry with him, and Abu Nu'aym, Fadl ibn Dukayn, He kicked Yahya ibn Ma'in in the chest and tumbled him off the ground. If you don't know the story, then look it up, inshaAllah ta'ala. And al-Zuhriyu, Muhammad ibn Muslim ibn Shihab al-Zuhriyu, al-Imam al-Zuhriyu, rahimahullah. Wahaddathani Mahmudun, and Muhammad told me. Who is it? Yahya ibn Mahmud here is Ibn Ghaylan. Bukhari then said, here, ha. If you just look at it, there's a letter ha, right? This ha is called at-tahwil. Is it not there? وحدثني محمود. Just before it, he said عن الزهري ha, right? It doesn't say it? Yeah? Okay. But it says number two in Arabic, right? That place, Ani Zuhriyu, there, it's meant to have a hat on there. Hat means tahweel. Bukhari is moving away to another chain. Another chain of what? Of people who narrated from Zuhri. Here he brought it between Zuhri and Imam al-Bukhari. Is how many people? Abu Nu'ayn, Fadl ibn Dukayn, and Ibn Uyayna, yani Sufyan ibn Uyayna. Two people and then Zuhri is the third, right? Then he bought another chain, which is وحدثني, and I was told, Bukhari saying this, محمود told me, أخبرنا عبد الرزاق. عبد الرزاق here is عبد الرزاق من همام الصنعاني. قال أخبرنا معمر. معمر here is معمر بن راشد. عن الزهري محمد شهاب الزهري. Then between Bukhari here is what? محمود, عبد الرزاق, معمر, three between him and what? So he's trying to say I go to Zuhri in these two ways. عن عروة, يعني عروة بن زبير. عن أسامة بن زيد رضي الله تعالى عنه قال أشرف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. What does أشرف mean? It means صعد. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he climbed. The Prophet climbed عليه الصلاة والسلام. He climbed. أي اطلع من علو. There was two buildings in Medina and the Prophet climbed the top of the building عليه الصلاة والسلام. على أطم من آطام المدينة. أطم is a what? Hisnun, a fortress. He climbed the top of the fortress, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then when he stood at the top of the building, high place, the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said to the companions, Inni ara al-fitan. He looked at the city of Medina. He's in Medina. The Prophet looked at the city of Medina like that, and he said, I can see the fitna. I can see the fitan. Ara al-fitan khilala buyutikum kamawaqi' al-qatr. Some riwayat say, here it says, kawaq'i al-qatari. I see the fitan going into your household like the rain when it comes, it goes everywhere. The fitan is going to go everywhere. And why did the Prophet restrict Medina in the mentioning of here? Why? The reason is because the whole entire fitna started from what? It all started from the noble companion Uthman ibn Affan when he was killed. And where was Uthman killed in? The city of Medina. That's where he was killed. Uthman was murdered in Medina, cold blood. He was killed. Uthman was, he was put in a fortress. For days he couldn't leave his own house. Uthman radiallahu anhu. He couldn't leave. And he stayed there, alayhi salatu wasalam, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And when he stayed there for a period of time, some of the companions, they came to help him. Like Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali came and said, I'm here, I will help you. And then Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to Ali, do I have obedience on you? Do you still listen and obey me? And Ali said, of course, you are Amir al-Mu'mineen. You're the leader of the believers. He said, if you listen to me and you obey me and you consider me Amir al-Mu'mineen, I instruct and I command you to leave my building and put your sword away and don't touch anyone. I don't want anyone to defend me. And so Ali ibn Abi Talib left. And the Prophet Uthman radiallahu anhu stayed in his house. And the people rebelled against him. They first of all started by protesting. That's where it started from. Protest is what got rid of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. You see? And Uthman radiallahu anhu, what happened to him? He stayed in his house and he was fasting that day. They killed a man who was promised Jannah alive while he was walking on this earth. He knew he was going to enter Jannah. Uthman knew he was going to go Jannah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, wa Umar fil Jannah, wa Uthman fil Jannah, wa Ali fil Jannah. He named him, Uthman ibn Affan, by name. Uthman married the Prophet's two daughters and he earned a title called the Nurayn. Two of the Prophet's daughters. One died, and then the Prophet married him, the second one, Uthman radiallahu anhu. And that day Uthman died, he was fasting. And that day, he was reading his Quran, and they killed him. That's where the fitna started from. When that fitna started, ثُمَّ انْتَشَرَتِ الْفِتَنُ فِي الْبِلَادِ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ Hafiz al-Hajarin, he said, then the fitna didn't stop. Because that's when because of this, Ali and Muawiyah fought. It is because of this, Ali and Muawiyah fought. Are we all together? Ali ibn Abi Talib was telling Muawiyah, let's calm everyone down. Now Uthman just got killed. Ali was saying, let things cool down. Muawiyah was saying, no. The people who killed Uthman are not allowed to walk around and roam around the cities free from anything. I am Uthman's relative, I am his cousin. And Allah said in the Quran, وَمَنْ قُتِلَ مَظْلُومًا فَقَدْ جَعَلْنَا لِوَلِيهِ سُلْطَانًا فَلَا يُسْرِفْ فِي الْقَتْلِ If someone is killed wrongly, which is what happened to Uthman, he was killed wrongly. وَمَنْ قُتِلَ مَظْلُومًا فَقَدْ جَعَلْنَا لِوَلِيهِ We have made his people. Muawiyah said, I'm his people. Allah is saying to me here, if someone is killed, his family members are the one in charge of getting the blood money and getting these people to court. And then Ali ibn Abi Talib said, listen, if we now go after those people, those are the same people who had the audacity to kill Ali, Uthman. They are not in a position of weakness now. Let's calm things down and then we will go for them. Muawiyah responded and he said, I am in a position of power. How? Because Muawiyah was a governor of Sham. Huh? Muawiyah was the governor of Sham. And the people of Sham will take a bullet for Muawiyah. That's how much they love him. And they admire him. Are we all together? Which Ali didn't have. Ali never had people who listened and obeyed him. Like Muawiyah did. He had people who were submissive to him and do as he told them to do. Are we all together? So he said, if you can't do it, send them over to me, I will deal with them. And then Ali ibn Abi Talib said, who is Amir al-Mu'minin? Are you a governor or the leader of the Muslims? And then here fitna happened. So when the Prophet stood up, when the Prophet stood on Utum min Atam al-Madinah, that high building, and then he was saying, Inni ara al-fitan, I see the fitan. He was talking about this. That's going to start from Medina, and that's going to go all over the world. Are we all together? And then what happened to that fitna? That fitna went to Kufa, Iraq, and all of those lands. And then after that, the Ma'rakatu al-Nahrawan between the Khawarij and Ali ibn Abi Talib, which was Qadiyatu al-Tahkim, which was a result of the issue of Uthman radiallahu anhu. So everything that happened after the bloodshed was the Prophet's prophecy in saying that, I can see the fitna. Now this really teaches us a very big lesson, brothers, is that you may belittle a fitna that's going to start and say, well, this is it. But it's going to be blood. Uthman's led, it came to thousands of noble people died. Thousands of people died. Are we all together? In that fight that took place between Ali ibn Abi Talib and Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. We all together, brothers. If that happened at the time of noble people, Ahlu Khayrin wa Salah, people of righteousness, people of nobility, فَمَا بَأْلُكَ بِغَيْرِهِمْ What do you think about other than them? Are we all together, brothers? It's this time, brothers, that we need to be very cautious of what we say, what we promote, what we retweet, what we say things that can lead to fitan. And you might just be staying at home, and you've just said one word, and it's caused chaos in somewhere else. Either it can be someone's household or it can even be a country. And bloodshed took place because of what you said. Are we all together, brothers? Yeah. So be careful. Stay away from fitan. The Prophet, this is what he's trying to nurture his companions on. He's trying to nurture them upon what? To stay away from this, to be cautious of these fitan and to not fall into it. الإمام البخاري رحمه الله. There's something I do want to mention. The fitan, brothers, is calamities and hardship that I mentioned before. But what about if a person is not put through trials and tribulation? Allah never tests you. You never get sickness. You're always healthy. There's a hadith that came regarding that. There was a man, this hadith might shock some of you guys, but this hadith is authentic. And Imam Ahmad narrated it, and Bukhari narrated it in Adab al-Mufrad, and Al-Hakim narrated it in his Mustadrak, Bayhaqi narrated it in Hadith Abi Huraira. Al-Haythami, he considered it to be sahih. Sheikh Al-Albani, Sheikh Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Wadi'i, great scholars authenticated this hadith. This hadith is a Bedouin man entered onto the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one day. And then he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he entered, no, he came to the Prophet, the Bedouin man, and he stood next to the Prophet. And then the Prophet said to him, أَخَذَتْكَ أُمُّ مِلْدَمَ. Have you ever been afflicted with fever? Have you ever been afflicted with fever? قَالَ he then, this man said, no, I've never, what is fever? He said, وَمَا أُمُّ مِلْدَمَ. What is this? What's fever? And then the Prophet said, حَرٌّ يَكُولُ بَيْنَ الْجِلْدِ وَاللَّحْمِ. It's what brings your temperature up and makes you sick. قَالَ مَا وَجَدْتُ هَذَا قَطْ. He said, I never ever got a fever. قَالَ هَلْ أَخَذَكَ السُّدَاعُ قَطْ. Have you ever had a headache in your life? قَالَ وَمَا السُّدَاعُ. He said, what is headache? The Prophet said, عُرُوقٌ تَضْرِبُ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ فِي رَأْسِهِ. It is what? A vein that causes a person to feel sick and have a headache. قَالَ he said, مَا وَجَدْتُ هَذَا قَطْ. That has never happened to me. فَلَمَّا وَلَّى. When the man stood up and he walked away, the Prophet then said, مَنْ أَحَبَّ أَنْ يَنْظُرَ إِلَى رَجُلٍ مِنْ أَهْلِ النَّارِ فَلْيَنْظُرْ إِلَى هَذَا. The Prophet said, if anyone wants to look at a man from the people of the hellfire, let me look at that man. Anyone who wants to look at a man from the people of the hellfire, let him look at what? This man. وَلِذَلِكَ جَمْهَرَةٌ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ. A large quantity of scholars, they took from it that it's not a good sign when you're never afflicted with calamities or hardship, and you're always healthy. Because it's a form of what? Expiation for your sins to go, and it's also to raise your station. That doesn't mean you say, oh Allah, I've never been sick, make me sick now. You don't ask for it. You don't ask for it. But some of the Salaf, rahimahumullah, they used to what? They used to ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to give them health, but when they didn't get sick, they used to get worried. They used to what? When they used to get worried. Because they used to see it as the good has been hastened for them in this world. All the good has what? Has been brought for you. The non-Muslim, because he's done maybe good in this world, the non-Muslim, Allah is not oppressive. So Allah gives him the good that he did in the dunya, Allah gives it to him in his dunya. Huh? Lakin nothing for him in the akhirah. That's what Allah said, وَلَوْلَا أَن يَكُونَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً لَجَعَلْنَا لِمَنْ يَكْفُرُ بِالرَّحْمَنِ لِبُيُوتِهِمْ سُقُفًا مِنْ فِضَّةٍ وَمَعَارِجَ عَلَيْهَا يَظْهَرُونَ وَلِبُيُوتِهِمْ أَبْوَابٌ وَسُرُرًا عَلَيْهَا يَتَّكِئُونَ وَزُخْرُفًا وَإِنْ كُلُّ ذَلِكَ لَمَّا مَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Akhirah is only for the believers. So some people, they get whatever they do good, Allah gives it to them in this dunya. But then they come the day of judgment, وَبَدَى لَهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُونُوا يَحْتَسِبُونَ. The day of judgment, they see what they were not expecting. May Allah not make us from those people. What we also take from this hadith is the importance of knowledge of the fitan. Because look, if the Prophet ﷺ stood up on top of a building and he looked at the fitan and he said, I can see the fitna, the Prophet mentioned many of those fitna. He stated many of those fitna. And the fitna, as we're going to see later, one of its signs is when knowledge decreases. The people have no knowledge. They don't understand, brothers. Ignorance is an illness, brothers. Some people are walking around and they are sick, but they don't realize. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ انْتِزَاعًا يَنْتَزِعُ مِنْ صُدُورِ الرِّجَالِ وَلَكِنْ يَقْبِضُ الْعِلْمَ بِقَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِ عَالِمًا اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. That Allah does not take knowledge all at once, but Allah takes those who have knowledge. حَتَّى إِذَا لَمْ يُبْقِ عَالِمًا, until there is no person of knowledge left, اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا. The people, they appoint ignorant people. They make them the reference point. فَسُئِلُوا, those ignorant ones are asked. فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, and they give fatwa with no knowledge. فَضَلُّوا, they misguide themselves. وَأَضَلُّوا, and they misguide others. They misguide themselves and they misguide others. Imagine, my beloved brothers and sisters, Al-Imam Malik, Imam Dar al-Hijra, was asked 40 questions. 40 questions were put to him. 33 of those questions. And 34 of those questions, he said, La adiri, Allahu alam. Who are we talking about? Al-Imam Malik, Imam Dar al-Hijra. He said, La adiri. Abdullah ibn Umar, a man came up to him and he asked him a question. Abdullah ibn Umar. And Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, La adiri, I don't know, Allahu alam. And the man then said to him, You, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab, you don't know? Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, La adri, Allahu alam. This shows you that just because someone makes you feel like you've been studying for this long, why don't you know it? The poet, he said, or the scholars they mentioned, or the poet, he said, وَالْكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَلَاحِ الْأَرْبَعَ يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي فَكُنْ مُتَّبِعَ. All of the scholars, they used لا أدري as their shield. If someone throws a weapon or arrow at you, what do you use? You use a shield, right? The fatwa that you're being asked is an arrow. Are we all together? If you don't answer it properly, it can hit you in the wrong place. So what do? You got your shield. So the person who misses out and doesn't use لا أدري أصيبت مقاتله, the arrow is going to hit him and it's going to kill him. So what we need to understand is that we need to take issues back to people of knowledge. But the people of knowledge that we take it back to, they have two characteristics. Write this down. As the poet, he said, وَلَيْسَ فِي فَتْوَاهُ مُفْتٍ مُتَّبِعٍ مَا لَمْ يُضِفْ لِلْعِلْمِ وَالدِّينِ الْوَرَعِ. The person that you're taking the issue back to and you're asking the fatwa for is مَنْ جَمَعَ بَيْنَ الْعِلْمِ وَالْوَرَعِ. He combines between knowledge and piety. He is a pious individual and he also has knowledge. What about if you have two people and they're both knowledgeable and they have piety? And they give a fatwa in an issue that are opposing to each other. One says right and the other one says left. And they both have to, in accordance to your knowledge, they have al-ilmu wa-deen wal-wari'. They have wara', they have knowledge, and they both seem the same to you. What do you do in a situation like that? Then find a third one who has knowledge and piety, and then take the one whose opinion he strengthens. Ah. Are we all together? That's what Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah mentioned. It shocked me that even Nabiullah Muhammad was asked a question and he didn't know the answer to it and then he chose not to answer it. Who? Nabiullah Muhammad. The Prophet ﷺ, in the famous hadith in Sahih Muslim, he divided the khayl, the horse, into three types. People own horses for three reasons the Prophet mentioned. And you can go there and find it in Sahih Muslim. And then a man said to the Prophet ﷺ, what about a donkey? Because he had a donkey, he wanted to know, you spoke about the horse, what about the donkey? Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ فِيهَا شَيْءٌ إِلَّا هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ الْجَامِعَةُ الْفَادَّةِ. Allah hasn't sent on me anything regarding that question you asked me. Who is saying that? Nabiullah Muhammad is saying, I have no answer for the question you're asking me. Allah hasn't sent me anything regarding it. But I'm going to give you a general ayah that can inshallah encompass all of that, which is, قوله تعالى فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يرى ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يرى. هذا هو. The ayah encompassed the fatwa of the Prophet ﷺ generally, but the beginning he said Allah hasn't sent me anything regarding it. Allah has not sent me what? Anything regarding it. So what we need to understand is, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا. Don't say what you don't have knowledge of. وَمَنْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَا تَقُولُ لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. There's some people that are just doing that. Halal, haram, and they have no knowledge of it. Especially social media nowadays. Someone comes up to you and asks you a question, brother, do you have the answer to this question? Give me a second, I'll Google it. He Googles it, gets the answer, he goes, yeah, it's permissible, inshallah ta'ala. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Are we all together, brothers? These websites that people go on and they get answers from it, that question on the website is not tailored for you. Call the people of knowledge and ask them. Are we all together? There are questions that you can look at, whether they are halal and haram, like, for instance, issues which are generally a general ruling for everybody, which is Dhuhr is 4 rak'ah, you can look it up online and the evidence for that. And Asr is 4 rak'ah, you can look up that online inshaAllah ta'ala. But there are issues that you have regarding your, I was angry and I divorced my wife, call a sheikh. Don't look at the fatwa online, because the sheikh might hear from your situation something that may change the whole entire fatwa. Does that make sense? And that's what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala commanded us in the Quran, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of what? Ask the people of knowledge. Go back to them and ask them. So brothers, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam climbing that high building and him talking about the fitna happening, if you want to know all the fitan and you understand it, read the ahadith of the Prophet. Rather, Shaykhul Islam ibn Taymiyyah said something very powerful. He said, the ulama, the people of knowledge, يعرفون الفتن, they know the fitna قبل وقوعها, before it even happens. They, when it's about to happen, they say, people, be careful, this is a fitna, it's going to come, it's going to destroy us. And the people, some choose to listen and some choose not to listen. And then the fitna happens. He says, Shaykhul Islam, the amma, the general mass, they only realize that they were in a fitna, not whilst they're in it, but once it's gone and it's turned its back and the fitna has left, they say, you know what? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We were in a fitna all along. That's what they say. They only realize it when it's gone and it's turned its back on them. So, ilm, brothers. قال الإمام البخاري رحمه الله باب ظهور الفتن قال حدثنا عياش بن الوليد قال أخبرنا عبد الأعلى قال حدثنا معمر عن الزهري عن سعيد عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يتقارب الزمان وينقص العمل ويلقى الشح وتظهر الفتن ويكثر الهرج ويكثر الهرج قالوا يا رسول الله أيما هو قال القتل القتل وقال شعيب ويونس والليث وابن أبي أخي زهر وابن أخي الزهري عن الزهري عن حميد عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا عبيد الله بن موسى عن العمش عن شقيق قال كنت مع عبد الله وأبي موسى فقال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن بين يدي الساعة لأياما ينزل فيها الجهل ويرفع فيها العلم ويكثر فيها الهرج والهرج القتل قال حدثنا عمر بن حفص قال حدثنا أبي قال حدثنا الأعمش قال حدثنا شقيق قال جلس عبد الله وأبو موسى فتحدثا فقال أبو موسى قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن بين يدي ساعة أياما يرفع فيها العلم وينزل فيها الجهل ويكثر فيها الهرج والهرج القتل قال حدثنا قتيبة قال حدثنا جرير عن الأعمش عن أبي وائل قال إني لجالس مع عبد الله وأبي موسى رضي الله عنهما فقال أبو موسى سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مثله والهرج بلسان الحبشة القتل قال حدثنا محمد قال حدثنا غندر قال حدثنا شعبة عن واصل عن أبي وائل عن عبد الله وأحسبه رفع قال بين يدي ساعة أيام الهرج يزول العلم ويظهر فيها الجهل بين يدي ساعة أيام الهرج يزول العلم ويظهر فيها الجهل قال أبو موسى والهرج القتل بلسان الحبشة وقال أبو عوانة عن عاصم عن أبي وائل عن الأشعري أنه قال لعبد الله تعلم الأيام التي ذكر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أيام الهرج نحوه قال ابن مسعود قال ابن مسعود سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من شرار الناس من تدركهم الساعة وهم أحياء. Al-Imam al-Bukhari here says, بَابُ ظُهُرُ الْفِتَنِ. The fitan becoming apparent and becoming clear. And Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah here, he says, حَدَّثَنَا عَيَّاشِ إِبْنُ الْوَلِيدِ الْبَصْرِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا عَبْدُ الْأَعْلَى يعني عبد الأعلى السامي حَدَّثَنَا مَعْمَرُ وهو ابن راشدٍ عن الزهري عن سعيدٍ وهو ابن المسيبي. سعيد هي سعيد بن المسيب عن أبيه هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يتقارب الزمان. What does it mean يتقارب الزمان? This is a question. The time will become close. Amma, the time will pass rapidly. What does that mean? يتقارب الزمان. There are more than 20 views regarding that. يتقارب الزمان. 20 قولاً 20 views what it means, يتقارب الزمان. What the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant by it. I'm going to mention the two strongest opinions regarding يتقارب الزمان. I'm going to mention the first opinion, which is يتقارب الزمان. It means يتقارب أهل الزمان. The people of that time are going to be the same. The scholars are going to be the same. The people of knowledge, there isn't going to be a person who's higher than another. They're all going to be equal and equivalent to one another. يَتَقَارَبُ الزَّمَانِ أَيْ يَعْنِي يَتَقَارَبُ أَهْلُ الزَّمَانِ. This is the call of Ibn Battal. Ibn Hajar brings it in his Kitab Fath al-Bari. He says, قال Ibn Battal, ليس في هذا الحديث ما يحتاج إلى تفسير غير قوله يتقارب الزمان ومعناه والله أعلم تقارب أهل أحوال أهلي في قلة الدين حتى لا يكون فيه من يأمر بمعروف ولا ينهى عن منكر لغلبة الفسق وظهور أهله وقد جاء في الحديث لا يزال الناس بخير ما تفاضلوا فإذا تساووا هلكوا يعني لا يزالون بخير ما كان فيهم أهل الفضل وصلاح وخوف من الله يلجأ إليهم عند الشدائد ويستثنى بآرائهم ويترك بدعائهم ويؤخذ بتقويتهم ويؤخذ بتقويهم وآثارهم. Ibn Battal رحمه الله, he takes the opinion that one of the signs of the hour that the hadith is referring to is when the people become the same and they become equal in knowledge. There isn't a person they look up to in knowledge and understanding. And even in our time that we were living, we saw a time when there were great noble imams like Sheikh Al-Allama Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz and Sheikh Al-Allama Muhammad Nasiruddin Al-Albani and Sheikh Al-Allama Muhammad Ibn Salih Al-Uthaymeen. And when they were alive, a lot of the fitnas were absent from the Muslims. This unity was very far. People went to Sham, Sheikh Albani would tell them something. They went to Mamlaka al-Arabiya Saudiya, they met Ibn Baz, he would say the same thing. They went to Unayza, to Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, he would say the same thing. Bima'na, the people were united. Are we all together, brothers? When they died, the furqa and the khilaf was so large. So large, it was apparent after the death of these great imams. So when the people become the same in knowledge and they become equal to each other in knowledge, it becomes a problem because they become aqran, contemporaries, and all they do is they go at each other. You see? Like when there are superior seniors that are present and the people are not the same, then it's khair. Walidhalika, you see in countries like Western countries where there are people who are giving da'wah, because there is no higher level of people to go back to, it causes disunity in those countries. Alhamdulillah, a lot of the Arab countries, they still have that ulama they go back to, seniors. Like in some places in the world, like Western countries, it's hard to find that person who's gone back to. And people go back to and they see him as a reference point. It's very little, it's very hard to find. And this is from the signs of the hour. And it brings about fitan, trials and tribulations, when the people become the same. Becomes what? Becomes a problem. The second opinion is يَتَقَارَبُ الزَّمَانِ. It means, and the second view is a view pushed by an Imam al-Nawawi. يَتَقَارَبُ الزَّمَانِ means the barakah is taken from the time. يَتَقَارَبُ الزَّمَانِ means that the time, the barakah is taken from it. And the evidence that an Imam al-Nawawi used is the hadith لَا تَقُومُ السَّاعَةَ حتى يتقارب الزمان فتكون السنة كالشهر ويكون الشهر كالجمعة وتكون الجمعة كاليوم ويكون اليوم كالساعة وتكون الساعة كالضمرة بالنار. The hour will not come until the time becomes the same, meaning the time loses its barakah. What does it lose? The barakah. The person has 24 hours, like the early people had 24 hours, but he can't produce the things that they produced. The barakah is taken from the time. ولذلك, it shocks. If you look at the biography of some scholars, like Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam al-Shafi'i was only 53 years old when he died. Imagine, the great Imam, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, that's followed, he died, was only 53 years old. That's young, right? Very young. Al-Imam al-Nawwi, who when you go to nearly every house, Riyad al-Salihin is there, Arba'un al-Nawawiyya, Al-Adhkar, he died when he was 45. Are we all together, brothers? 45 years of age. How did he do all of that in that time, in his lifespan? Sharh al-Sahih Muslim, Sharh al-Muhaddab li-Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi, his Kitab al-Irshad, the book Riyad al-Salihin, Arba'un al-Nawawiyya. Like, how did he do all of this? Al-Adhkar, how did he write all of these works and he's only 45? Barakah. Allah put barakah in a time. ولذلك there's a hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم where he said, من سره أن يبسط له في رزقه. Anyone who wants Allah to open his provision for him. If you want Allah to give you rizq. وَيُنْشَأَ لَهُ فِي أَجَلِهِ. And Allah to lengthen your lifespan for you. فَلِيَصِلْ رَحِمَهُ. Keep the ties of kinship. Keep the what? The ties of kinship. Two things the hadith mentioned. If you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you rizq, and if you want Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to give you a long life, keep the ties of kinship. Know about your family and their well-being, and how they are and what they are doing. Do that. The scholars, they differ amongst themselves. What does it mean that Allah will lengthen the lifespan of that person? Does it mean haqiqatun ma'nawiyatan? Does it literally mean I was going to live for 40 years and it gets pushed to 60 years? Is that what it means? Or does it mean that my 40 years is going to feel like 60 years? Does that make sense? The scholars, they have their opinion. Some of the scholars, they believe it's haqiqatan that Allah is going to increase you in your lifespan if you keep your ties of kinship. And some scholars, they believe Allah will put barakah in your time. And it will feel like, even though you lived for a very short time, but you will be able to achieve what a person who's lived maybe double your life has achieved. وَهُوَ الْأَقْرَبُ. And that seems to be closest in that way. That seems to be closest. So from the signs of the hour is time finishing. SubhanAllah, it was just recently when we entered 2019, right? And here it is as well. 2020. You know, when I realized that SubhanAllah, it's coming to an end. When I was walking and someone came up to me and said to me, "Uncle, how are you doing?" They called me uncle. I was like, whoa. I remember yesterday when I was very young. Time's coming to an end. And that's why Allah said in the Quran, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. Allah says, have we not given you a time for you to live? أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ. We gave you a lifespan that you can think and you can ponder. يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. And the warner came to you. Some of the scholars, they said, the warner here is white hair. Abdullah ibn Abbas said that. وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرِ يَعْنِ الشَّيْبِ. I have one over here. I think it's stress. It's nothing to do with age. Don't worry. But that's the truth. It's the reality. We are being reminded that our time is coming to an end. You see? Recently, I don't want to mention names, but someone died and everyone was talking about it on social media. At a very young age, wasn't preparing for it. مُفَاجَأَةً. I definitely didn't know he was going to die at that moment. Like, and this is the reality. Every single day, everyone's getting closer to their grave. Every day you grow older and your life goes by 1 year, it's actually you getting closer to your what? You're getting closer to your grave. And that is, and because time is like that, we need to benefit from it every day. Are we all together? We need to what? The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, and I sometimes see people because they're driving, you've got a car, or you're on a public transport, or you're on a plane. Benefiting from your time can also be just doing dhikr. Sitting in a car, just do your dhikr whilst you're driving. You've got stitches. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, كلمتان خفيفتان على اللسان ثقيلتان في الميزان حبيبتان إلى الرحمن سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم. Very light on the tongue, very heavy on the scale, very beloved to Allah تبارك وتعالى. سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, من قال في اليوم 100 مرة سبحان الله وبحمده غفرت ذنوبه وإن كانت مثل زبد البحر. Anyone who says سبحان الله وبحمده 100 times a day, Allah will forgive you your sins even if it's a what? Even if it's as large as the ocean. The sins that you came with. Are we all together? But is it heavy to say Bismillah, Subhanallah wa bihamdi? 100 times a day, bis. And all of your sins will be forgiven however large they are. However what? Large the sins that you've done is. So you can be benefiting from your time. ولذلك when the man came to the Prophet, he said, إِنَّ شَرَائِعَ الْإِسْلَامِ قَدْ كَثُرَتْ فَأَخْبِرْنِي بِشَيْءٍ أَتَشَبَّتُ بِهِ. The legislation has become too much on me. He was a man, simple man. He came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, I don't know all of these fiqh and all of these knowledge. It's too much for me. I'm a simple man. إِنَّ شَرَائِعَ الْإِسْلَامِ قَدْ كَثُرَتْ. The legislation of the religion are too much now. I don't know all of this. فَأَخْبِرْنِي بِشَيْءٍ. Tell me something. Something. فَأَخْبِرْنِي بِشَيْءٍ أَتَشَبَّتُ بِهِ. Just tell me one thing I can hold on to. The Prophet looked at him and he said to him, لَا يَزَالُ لِسَانَكَ رَطْبًا مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Do not let your tongue dry from the remembrance of Allah. Your tongue, do not let it dry from the remembrance of Allah. The Prophet came to Mu'adh ibn Jabal and when he said, يَا مُعَادْ وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأُحِبُّكَ. Mu'adh, I love you. The Prophet saying this to who? Mu'adh. Mu'adh, وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأُحِبُّكَ فَلَا تَدَعَنَّ. Do not leave off. أن تقول في دبر كل صلاة at the ending of every صلاة to say اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. Don't, I love you, don't leave this off. صح. So the person should always just remember Allah. It's something very, and you know what's amazing, الإمام كتب الصحاح, they narrated that the Prophet ﷺ, he said عبادة في الحرج كهجرة إليها. عبادة at the time of killing, the times of fitna, ibadah at that time is like doing hijrah to me. The Prophet ﷺ said that. Ibadah at the times of fitan, yani dhikr, just doing dhikr. Remembering Allah when everybody's on social media, what happened, how many people died. You leave off all of that and you do dhikr and you do ibadah and you busy yourself with getting closer to Allah. Kahijratin ilayya, it's like doing hijrah to me. You see? يتقارب الزمان. The Prophet ﷺ, he said at the time, the barakah is taken from it. وينقص العمل, and the actions reduce. And another riwayat says وينقص العلم. Does yours say knowledge? This one just says actions. Some of the riwayat mentions وينقص العلم, the knowledge reduces. وينقص العمل. أما وينقص العلم ويلقى الشح, and the people are gonna be what? They are going to be stingy. They are going to be what? Stingy. That's what's going to happen. وَتَظْهَرُ الْفِتَنُ, and the fitan starts to happen. Starts to take place. It becomes apparent. ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. The fitan becomes apparent on this earth. وَيَكْثُرُ الْحَرْجُ, and killing increases. The death becomes what? The death toll becomes what? It becomes too much. Nowadays, if you look at the internet and you see what's taking place and the people who are dying, it's now reached a point where if you hear someone died, it's like, yeah, you become desensitized to it. And the Prophet ﷺ, one day he came to the Kaaba and he said to the Kaaba, what is greater than you? What is better than you? Meaning, how great you are. إلا دم امرؤ مسلم, except the blood of a believer is better than you. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا زوال الدنيا, the destruction of this entire world. لا زوال الدنيا أهون عند الله من قتل امرؤ مسلم. The destruction of this entire world is lighter to Allah than the blood of a believer. The entire world. Today, if someone was to go and attack the Kaaba, how would all the Muslims feel? Yeah. The blood of a believer is more sacred to Allah than the Kaaba. The blood of a what? Of a believer. It's so sacred to. What's going to happen is, the killing has become, it becomes a lot. قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَيُّمَا هُوَ. So they asked the Prophet, what is Al-Harj? And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, Al-qatlu al-qatlu. Al-harju is what? Killing, killing. That's what it is. Here there's an i'tirad, Hafiz ibn Hajar brings in Fathul Bari, which is Al-harju, is it an Arabic word? Because in the riwayat he mentions that it's a kalima habashiyya, right? Hafiz ibn Hajar argues that the word Al-harju is a kalima, it's a word, fasihatu fi lughati al-Arab. It's an Arabic word. And it means an ikhtilat, when things mix. That's what it means. Lakin in the Habashi word, in the Habashi language, the word al-harju means qatl mubashara. Lakin in the Arabic language, it means al-ikhtilat wal-ikhtilaf, wa huwa, and it is tasmiyatu shay'i ila ma ya'ulu ilayhi. It is naming something to what it's going to lead to. Because when people have ikhtilaf, and they argue between one another, then it leads to killing and fighting and bloodshed. So it is an Arabic word. It just doesn't mean killing. It means the muqaddimah, the beginning of what leads to killing. Does that make sense? The reason why Hafiz ibn Hajar is arguing like that is because Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is the one who said that it's an Arabic word. As we see in the narration here, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he mentions that the word al-harju, it means al-qatlu, in the Arabic language. Mm-hmm. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he then said, "Inna bayna yaday sa'ati la ayyaman." There are days to come. Yanzilu fiha al-jahlu. Ignorance will come down. Wa yurfa'u fiha al-ilmu. And knowledge will be lifted. Wa yakthuru fiha al-harju. Please listen to this and ponder over this. The killing is always mentioned in the context of knowledge going and ignorance becoming apparent. When ignorance comes about and knowledge goes, people will kill one another. They will kill one another. And it will increase. Now the hadith didn't say, وَيَقَعُ الْهَرْجُ. Killing will happen. Because killing happened at the time of the people who were most knowledgeable. صح? But he said, وَيَكْثُرُ فِيهَا الْهَرْجُ. The killing will increase. It will become what? It will become a lot. And it only becomes a lot when the knowledge decreases. And ignorance prevails. When ignorant prevails and becomes seen. حدثنا عمر بن حفص حدثنا أبي حدثنا الأعمش قال حدثنا الشقيق قال جلس عبد الله عبد الله هي عبد الله بن مسعود وأبو موسى يعني أبو موسى الأشعري فحدثا they both said إن بين يدي الساعة أياما يرفع فيها العلم وينزل فيها الجهل ويكثر فيها الهرج والهرج القتل قال حدثنا قتيبة بخاري says حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد قال حدثنا جرير يعني ابن عبد الحميد عن الأعمش يعني سليمان بن مهران عن أبي وائل شقيق بن أبي وائل قال إني لجالس مع عبد الله وأبي موسى رضي الله عنهما فقال أبو موسى said سمعت النبي I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying like that meaning saying to عبد الله بن مسعود what you heard from the Prophet I also heard from him قال حدثنا محمد بخاري says حدثنا محمد and Muhammad here is ابن بشار قال حدثنا غندر أن غندر هي إز محمد بن جعفر الهذلي قال حدثنا شعبة شعبة إز أبو بسطام العتكي أبو بسطام العتكي شعبة بن حجاج أبو بسطام العتكي قال هي سن عن واصل وهو ابن حيان الأحدب عن أبي وائل عن عبد الله يعني ابن مسعود وأحسبه رفعه قال بين يدي ساعة أيام Before the hour, there are going to come days of killing, bloodshed. يَزُولُ الْعِلْمُ Knowledge will be removed. There won't be much knowledge. وَيَظْهَرُ فِيهَا الْجَهْلُ And ignorance becomes apparent. All of this is so apparent what the Prophet ﷺ is saying. وَقَالَ أَبُو عَوَانَةَ عَنْ عَاصِمٍ By the way, this hadith, Bukhari didn't bring it with his sanad. Okay, he didn't bring his sanad. The reason why he didn't is because in the chain of this hadith is عاصم ابن أبي نجود عاصم ابن أبي نجود is now what? شعبة and حفص Who do they narrate from? عاصم The Qari, right? Asim, even though he's a hujjah in the Quran, he's da'if in hadith. He's what? Hadith is not taken from him. He's weak in hadith. The scholars, the hadith, they don't take him. So Bukhari, because of that, he didn't want to narrate it with a chain. And this benefits of something else that we can take from this, which is, Allah might make you a scholar in one thing, but maybe not in another thing. Sah? Asim, what's the Quran, generally the Quran that we prayed Maghrib with? The Salah that we prayed with right now was what? Hafs, right? Hafs narrate from who? Asim. Shu'ba narrates from who? Asim, right? So we Hafs and Asim, that's what we read with our Salah. Asim is a hujjah in the Quran. Hujjah, he's a proof. If you say Asim said, that's it. You don't have to bring evidence for it. The evidence is the fact that you said he said it. Lakin he's in hadith what? Da'if. He's what? In hadith da'if. Why? The scholars of hadith have a different set of criteria. There's a lot of other things that are taken into consideration. This shows us that Allah might open for you within the religion of Islam a chapter. You might like something within the deen. And you're good at it. And you know you love it. You have passion for it. You're most likely going to do better in that than trying to do what? Everything. But it's good to have knowledge of everything. Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Salam, he said, مَا نَظَرْتُ مُتَفَنِّنٍ Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Salam said, مَا نَظَرْتُ I never debated a mutafannin. A mutafannin is a person who puts his leg in everything. إِلَّا غَلَبْتُ Except I beat him in a debate. And I've never debated a mutakhassis, a person who specialized in one thing, except that he beats me all the time. Because he only stuck to what he knows. Sah? So it's always important to just give yourself something that you have a deep understanding of. So Bukhari rahimahullah, he didn't narrate it with a chain. And in Ash'ari annahu qala li Abdullah ta'lamu al-ayyam allati dhakara an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam ayyam al-harj nahwahu qala ibn Mas'ud sami'tu an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam yaqulu min shirar an-nas. This hadith, we want to stand over it. Min shirar an-nas, from the evilest of people are man tudrikum as-sa'atu wa hum ahya. A people who the hour's going to happen on them and they are alive. If the qiyamah happens and you're alive, it's a problem. Based on this hadith. This hadith shows that the qiyamah will only happen to the evilest of people. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen to what? The worst of people. So what do we do here? With the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, لا تزال طائفة من أمتي ظاهرين على الحق حتى تقوم الساعة. That there is always going to be a group of people who are apparent on the truth until the hour comes. And this hadith is saying, the only people who are going to be remaining when the hour comes are the evil people. Rather, in another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَا تَقُومُ السَّاعَةِ The hour will not come. عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ يَقُولُ اللَّهُ اللَّهُ The hour will not come and the word Allah is known. The name Allah, no one's saying it. It's gone. No one knows what Allah is. To the extent of some of the narrations mentioned, a man will be said to him Allah and he will say, I heard that from somewhere. Riwayat Thabita Sahih mentioned this. That the people are going to say, I heard Allah from somewhere. Where was that? Where did I hear that from? That any knowledge is going to go that low. These are evil people that are left. Are we all together? How do we then reconcile that with the hadith that says there's always going to be people who are apparent on the truth? لا يضر من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله. حتى تقوم الساعة. Some of the riwayat said until the hour comes. How do we reconcile between them? Hafiz ibn Hajar says, Ibn Hajar in Fath al-Bari, he says, والجمع بينه وبين حديث لا تزال طائفة حبل الغاية في حديث لا تزال طائفة على وقت هبوط الريح الطيبة التي تقبض روح كل مؤمن ومسلم فلا يبقى إلا شراره فتهجم الساعة عليه بغتة كما سيأتي بيانه بعد قليل. Ibn Hajar said it's easy. The righteous people are going to stay and they're going to go when the wind comes. There's going to come a wind and the righteous people, the wind that's going to take them. When that wind comes, that's the hour for those righteous people. And then the evil people are going to remain until the blowing of the trumpet. Are we all together? فإذا نفخ في الصور فصعق من في السماوات والأرض إلا من شاء الله ثم نفخ في أخرى فإذا هم قيام ينظرون. The trumpet is blown twice. The first time, the ones who are alive, they're going to die. And the second time it is blown, those who are dead are going to resurrect. صح؟ So the first time when he gets blown, the people who is going to be blown on are evil people. شرار خلق الله. The worst of people are going to be that day. And then, what's the problem with these people, brothers? What's the fitna that they have? Al-jahlu. They have no knowledge. They stop seeking knowledge. They stop learning. They left their deen and put it to the side. And they went to their businesses and their jobs. Fitna.